Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the first of our assembly hour lectures for the year. So you juniors and seniors are familiar with this. On Tuesday, we have an opportunity to bring some speakers in to talk about a lot of different topics. And we have a really special one to kick off the year this year. I'm going to read a little bit about them real quickly, and then we'll have a video, and then we'll have a chance for them to kind of tell their stories. Dachau concentration camp was the first of the Nazi concentration camps opened in Germany intended to hold political prisoners. It is located on the grounds of an abandoned munitions factory northeast of the medieval town of Dachau, about 10 miles northwest of Munich in the state of Bavaria in southern Germany. It was opened in 1933 by Heinrich Himmler and was enlarged to include forced labor and eventually the imprisonment of Jews, German and Austrian criminals, and eventually foreign nationals from the countries that Germany occupied or invaded during World War II. Dachau was liberated by U.S. forces in April of 1945. Among the liberators was Battle of Bulge veteran Don Greenbaum from Philadelphia of the 7th U.S. Army, a forward observer with the 283rd Field Artillery Battalion. Among that day, also that day among the liberated, was that of Ernie Gross. These two living historians will recount and discuss the horrors encountered at Dachau and their stories of survival. The History Channel has done an extensive documentary on their story. Mr. Gross and Mr. Greenbaum speak all over the country. They've been doing that for 9 years now since they found each other in telling the story. And they'll talk a little bit about that. But when people start saying this Holocaust never happened, that's when people like Mr. Gross and Mr. Greenbaum came forward and said, I saw it. I was there. It happened. So today we have with these two gentlemen, Mr. Stephen Gross, son of Ernie, and then Don's wife Shelley is here, and his grandson Jamin is also here with us. So we appreciate all of you being here. So without any further ado, we're going to start the video, and then we'll bring Don and Ernie up to talk.
Like this. shot beside you.
Special to be welcomed into each family of you, and now I have a really, really big family sitting all around here, all around the table. I want to thank you for that. I was welcomed with very open arms. You put all your trust in me, and I hope I don't disappoint you tomorrow. I don't think so. It's became a really good piece of television. I hope you like it, and I hope you will also enjoy the next couple of days together with us. It's really special that you're all here. As Andrea said, it's not easy to return to Germany for the first time. And in a way, try to encounter history for the second time. But we do it together. We do it together as a family. And in this way, let's raise the glasses. L'chaim to all of you. Hi. Great to have you here.
Hi. One question.
Yeah. One question.
Did you invite the Jewish community to the movie?
Yes, I did.
And they will come?
Some of them. It's a big community. Some. It's a big community. We have to make decisions.
You have to wait. You have to wait to see
how big is it? How many Jews in Michigan?
9,000.
Are mostly Russian.
Did you invite not Jewish community?
Yes. Yes. Press.
Okay.
Press and
everybody is invited. Mishabab Baruch Abayin.
Whoever
comes is
press. It's not a public screening in a way. It's press and partners and people of politics and
as you know what you are doing.
Hopefully my colleagues do.
We tried our best.
I tried.
We'll let you know tomorrow.
Tell you what I have to say. I want to apologize if some of you have a hard time to understand me because of my accent. That's not my fault. When I came over here, I didn't have it. I got it. The main reason that I'm here today, because in 1944, I was forced to come here in cattle train. I was forced to go into the concentration camp. Now, the government invited me to come here, and they're willing to pay all my expenses. And I wanted to stay on the same place I was standing in 1940, April 45, to go into the crematorium, and somebody like Don Greenbaum liberated me. And it took me 60 years, to find American soldier to thank him. If you would have come an hour later, I wouldn't be here to talk to you. So I'm very happy to meet you all.
Okay, hear me? Can you hear me in the back? All right. You're going to hear two stories today. One about a 50-year-old kid outside a concentration camp looking in, and a 50-year-old kid in the camp looking out. You'll hear the story. World War II took 60 million lives, men, women, and children. Of the 60 million, 10%, or 6 million, 1 million children, 2 million women, 3 million men of the Jewish faith were slaughtered by the Nazis only because of their religion, and nobody cared. Today, ISIS is doing the same thing. They're killing Christians, and nobody cares. I'll tell you my story. I was out of high school. Well, first of all, let me tell you why we're here. All we wish from this audience today is when you hear our story, to go home tonight or the weekend and tell your parents or tell your friends what you heard. This is not a movie. It's not a book. This is live. We were both there. We both witnessed it. We're doing it now because in 10 years, Ernie's 88, I'm 92. In 10 years, there'll be no one left to tell our story. So we go from college to college, from church to church, to synagogue, wherever they need us, we're there to tell our story. My story started on June 20th, 1943, out of high school 8 days, and I was sworn in the United States Army. I was assigned to the 23rd Field Artillery Battalion and started basic training in Fort Rucker, Alabama. We learned how to march, how to clean our rifle, how to dig a foxhole, and over the doorway was the slogan, I'm 18 years old now, kill or be killed. Now, we were shown movies of the Germans being trained to kill us, and we were being trained to kill them at the age of 18. Rucker, Alabama, we got a basic training. From there, I went to Fort Sill, Oklahoma, and ended up being a radio technician. And my job in the artillery was a 105 howitzer division. A 105 is a small piece of artillery you hook up to a truck and take it anywhere you needed it. We served under 15 different divisions in 2.5 years. I was trained to be a forward observer. My job was to go ahead of my company, observe the enemy, and radio back the coordinates of the enemy, hopefully to destroy them. We landed on Utah Beach, and for the next 236 days, we're in constant combat. Went through France, Holland, Belgium, Luxembourg, liberating town after town. We were heroes of these little towns. They loved us. Flowers, kisses, wine, whatever we wanted. We liberated town after town. We finally hit the German border. Then it got tough. Now it wasn't a week, now it was day by day fighting. November 9th, 1944, I was wounded in Aachen, Germany, and sent back to a hospital to recuperate. I had about 4 days of R&R, and we were told to get back to our outfit. The Germans were getting a counterattack, and every man that could carry a gun and could walk was sent back into combat, known as the Battle of the Bulge. That started on December 16th and January 15th. Luckily, we stopped the German counterattack, and we kept on going. I served under Patton for a while. He was a great, great general. He made us wear a tie, keep our shoes shined, our belt buckles shined, and we kept on going. I'm going to fast forward because we're time limited, and Ernie had a really great story to tell you. After the Battle of the Bulge, we were told to go into Germany and to go into Munich. And to on the way to Munich, there was a little supply depot called Dachau, which supplied the German army with arms, ammunition, fuel for their tanks, and whatever the army needed. We were told to capture it and destroy it and go into Munich. Well, on our way there, we came across a horrible, horrible odor about 2 miles outside of the so-called supply depot called Dachau. Men were throwing up all over the place. It was horrible. To this day, 70 years later, I can identify that odor. Didn't know what it was. About a mile inside the perimeter, we came across boxcars, which I have pictures with me, and they with a strong stomach, I'll show them to you, of the bodies just thrown in like pieces of wood. 20 boxcars full of naked, dead people. The odor was from their bodies. Here I'm now 20 years old now. I'm already 2 years into the Army. We still didn't know what it was. We never heard the expression concentration camp, never heard the expression of a crematorium, and all of a sudden the sky was black. There was no sky. It was completely black. Now we're really confused. What are we walking into? We finally approached Dachau, which was a death camp. We did not know that. As we approached it, we heard nothing. It was very quiet. We entered the camp. We saw these men in pajama-clad uniforms, not knowing who they were. Every language in the world. We didn't recognize anybody. The guards of the camp threw their rifles down and ran. Those who stayed in the camp and tried to get in with the prisoners to actually hide were caught by the prisoners, and they were actually beaten to death by the prisoners. We still don't know what it was. Luckily, one of our men spoke Yiddish, and Yiddish is very close to Polish, and he said, "We're American soldiers. You're liberated." Well, I can't explain to you now. I get a chill just thinking about it. The elation, the happiness, they crawled up to kiss our feet. They wanted to hug us. They were so happy, and they wanted to leave the camp. The problem was, where were they going to go? There was nowhere to go. So they had to wait until we radioed back to the troops behind us to bring food and bring blankets and medicine, and we told them what we saw, and we couldn't even explain it. These were human beings killing human beings. Well, from there, we had to go into our next objective because the war was still on. We were there about 2 days. A French priest walked us through the camp, showed us the machine gun pits, the gas chamber, the crematorium, which to this day is still there, and we went on. Of course, May 8th, the war was over, and we were very happy about that on our way home. Then I had a good experience. First of all, 50 years later, no one talked about the Holocaust. We all started our families, went the GI Bill, went to college, got married, had children. Our whole new life was ahead of us. And then one day on 2020, a guy says, "The Holocaust never happened." A denier. Well, I called a college in Philly called Gratz College, predominantly Jewish college, and I said, "I was there. I want to tell my story." And I started speaking about the Holocaust a long, long time ago. I spoke to small groups here, small groups there, and I told my story. Well, about 10, 11 years ago, my wife and I were on our way to a birthday party in Cherry Hill, New Jersey, and I said to my wife, "Whose house is this? You know, they're sponsoring a birthday party for a friend of ours." She said, "Well, the fellow's name is Sidney Geller. He's the host and hostess." I said, "Shell, I never told you this. I know the guy in France is Sidney Geller. He was killed, and I was with him when he died. I wonder if these people are any relation to him." Got to the party, and I said, "Any relations to World War II? Oh, Uncle Sidney. I was named for Uncle Sidney." I said, "Well, I was with your uncle when he died." "Well, they want to hear all about Uncle Sidney. Was he tall, short? What kind of guy was he?" It was fantastic. Now, 5 years later, my wife was involved with a charitable organization called Terry Lynn Child Care Foundation, was sponsoring and checking in school teachers for award ceremony. And a guy signs in, Sidney Geller. I said, "Hey, did you have a relative in World War II?" "Yeah, my Uncle Sidney." Well, another one, this was a cousin, told the same story about that I met his cousin, so on and so forth. Unbeknownst to me, my wife, Shelley, wrote an article for a local newspaper called The Jewish Exponent. in the Philadelphia area. And in the article, she mentioned that I was a Florida Observer. I earned a Purple Heart, which I have with me, which I'm very proud to show you. Every man, woman is wounded or killed in World War in combat receives a Purple Heart. And that's mine. Thank you. Thank you. So they write the article, and the bottom line said I was part of the liberation company, the Liberated Dachau. Unbeknownst to me, about a week later, I got a phone call from a gentleman of Northeast Philadelphia, and he said, Don, there's a guy in our congregation who is a survivor at Dachau, would like to thank you for saving his life. And he gave me his name and number, and I called Ernie Gross. We had lunch with Steve, his son, Shelley, myself, and that was 9 years ago. I can't tell you how many speeches we've given in 9 years, but all we ask really is to tell somebody what you heard today. My story is one of many liberators. Ernie's survivors, they're dying off every day. He was there, he lived through it at the age of 15. So it's my pleasure now to give you my kid brother, like a brother, Ernie Gross, to tell his side of the story. Thank you.
In case you didn't recognize me in this film, I'm the only one with a white beard, and I'm the only one who has a young girl to my right, sometimes to my left also. I really don't know exactly what I'm going to talk to you about, but I believe in Judge Judy. I watch her almost every day. If you tell the truth, you don't have to memorize it. You don't have to write it down. I have a mental screen in front of me. Whatever I see there, I'm going to relate to you. Sometimes it's going to be sad, sometimes more sad, but it's also going to be a lot of humor. Because I remember the first time I spoke to the Rotary Club, and I was breaking down. I couldn't finish my story. It was giving me all the time Kleenex to wipe myself. Then I decided, well, how am I going to do this? I have to tell my story. Then I decided to mix in humor. That way I was able to go on. My name is Ernie Gross. I was born in Romania in a small town. We were a family of nine, my parents and seven children. Five brothers, two sisters. I also went to the bank and I took out golden dollars. They look like this. And when I'm done, I'm going to ask the students questions. If you know the answer, you will get one of those. When I was a young man, I was had a lot of confidence in myself. Either I had a lot of confidence in myself, or sometimes felt insecure. Either I, I knew I'm gonna get stuck here, but don't worry about it, it's gonna come to me. I had three older brothers than me, and I was the fourth child. To be born in the middle is the worst thing could happen to you. Like you're born in the wrong time, in the wrong place. Anything goes wrong, you're always in the middle. We had a house with two bedrooms and a kitchen. Everything that happened in that house was in the kitchen. The bedrooms is only to sleep. Each bedroom had two beds. Each bed, two people. So four beds is eight, but we were nine. So I'm the one, the leftover. Every time I had to ask my mother where I'm going to sleep tonight, she said to me, sleep with your father. Next time, sleep with your younger brother. The best I liked was she told me to sleep with my two older brothers. Why? In the morning when my mother made the bed and the sheet was wet, she never knew who did it. So, my life as a youngster was really not that good. because nothing was going for me. I never had any new clothes. Everything was handed down for my three older brothers. So I didn't like the way I looked. Either my pants were too short or they were too long. So I didn't like myself. In school, it was even worse. In the class, I was only one Jewish. Everybody knew that. And we were having lunch. Everybody was having lunch at a desk, and the teacher left. So when lunchtime came, I was eating my kosher lunch, and the other guys didn't like it. So they would come over, and they would rub either bacon or ham on my lips. I couldn't do nothing about it, because the guy who was doing it, next to him was three other students. So I figured I'd just take it in. When I went home, I was too ashamed to tell my three older brothers. And of course, I didn't tell my parents. So I was always sad looking. On Saturday, when I went to the synagogue, I heard him saying, "Here comes a boy who never left." So when I was liberated, I made myself a promise that every day I got to make 10 people laugh. So I hope I was able to do it here, because they didn't have time to make anybody laugh today. But nothing is as bad as what happened in 1944, April the 15th. Early in the morning, it was on a Sunday, was a knock at the door. It was nothing unusual to open the door, not even asking who was there. It happened to be two Hungarian police with a gun drawing. And here what they told us: if you have money in your pocket, put it on the table. If you have jewelry, take it off, put it on the table. Within an hour, you have to be in the synagogue. If we see you somewhere else, we have a right to shoot you. We didn't know why. They didn't tell us why. So everybody was following what they told us. When you leave the house, don't lock the door. So we're all getting out of the house, and we see from all directions Jewish people come into the synagogue. When everybody was there, they locked the doors. Those days, we didn't have any plumbing. We didn't have any electricity. We didn't have any water. So it was very uncomfortable to be in that synagogue. If somebody had to go to the bathroom, had to find a place in the corner. So after 2 days, it was kind of smelly there, and we didn't know why we were here, and we didn't know where we were going to go. The third day, they opened the door, and we were so happy we were going to have fresh air. But we didn't know there was a line horse and wagon. They told us to go in to those wagons. We were going to go deep into Hungary, in a ghetto. The houses we occupied there were empty, because those Jews already went to Auschwitz. So in one of the houses, they put in 3-4 families. So when nighttime came, everybody slept on the floor. We were there for 3 weeks, not knowing why we were there, not knowing where we were going to go. Finally, the cattle train came, and they shoved in the wagon as many people as is possible to go in, standing room only. Before they locked the door, they gave us a big bucket. Anybody has to go to the bathroom, has to go in that bucket. I don't know how long it took to get to Auschwitz. All I know is when the train stopped, they told us, anybody who has luggage, you can't take it with you. You have to leave it in the wagon. And out of confusion, we got out of the train. My parents were ahead of me with a younger brother, younger sister, that I never saw them again. Luckily, I was next to two older brothers, and I felt a little secured. We had to go through a line. In the front of the line was Mengele, and he made the decision who should live and who should die that day. And there were prisoners already working in Auschwitz from Poland, Jewish prisoners. Their job was to go into the train, take out all the luggage, put it in a wagon. One of them I saw he was looking at me all the time. So finally he jumped down the train, he came over to me. He says, how old are you? I said, I'm 15. He said, when you face the Nazi, you better say you're 17. If not, you're gonna go where your parents went. I said, where did my parents go? He said, because your father hold on to a younger brother and your mother to a younger sister, automatically he went to the left. I said, what happens when you go to the left? He said, you see those two buildings? They're gonna tell them to go into the first building to get undressed, they're gonna take a shower. Instead of shower, gas came. They died immediately. The next building is a crematorium. And then he tells me to look up at the sky, and he says, see how dark the smoke is? 4 hours from now, that's gonna be your parents' smoke. My brothers heard the same thing when he was talking to me. But as soon as he finished talking, whatever he told me just vanished. Like he never said anything. Now I was busy with myself. How about if he's not going to believe me? So when we get close enough to the Mangala, and he saw my two brothers, told them right away to go to the right. That means they're going to go to work. When my turn came, he just looked at me and scanned me. And he said to me in German, wie alt bist du? That means, how old are you? I said, 17. Because I was so scared, he didn't come out correctly. He didn't understand me. And he asked me again. I decided this time I'm going to stand up straight to make sure I say 17. So he told me to go to my right where my brothers is. We went into a building. We talked about everything, but not the information the prisoner gave us what's going to happen to the parents. So finally, they took us to work. Here, what happens before you leave Auschwitz? There's a field. In the middle is a table with electric shavers. They told us to get undressed, and we have to shave each other. Over the fence was a women's camp. They told them the same thing. When everybody was shaved everywhere, and we put on the prison clothes, you could not tell who is a woman, who is a man. We all looked alike. Because I was in Auschwitz such a short time, I don't have a number on my hand, but they put it on my prison clothes. And this number, I will never forget, is 71,366. Now I realize I really have nothing, not even my own clothes. I don't even have a name. I'm just a person. When we got into the camp, the name of the city was Kaufering. It's near 15 kilometers from Munich, and in that city was 7 camps. You start up with camp 1, and I'm going to show you what they gave us and what saved my life. First, they gave us a cup like this for aluminum. They told us, make sure you don't break it, make sure you don't lose it, because this is the one you're going to get your food. In the morning, we got a little bit of black coffee. When you came home at night, they gave you 3/4 soup. If you're lucky, you got a piece of potato in it. Sometimes I was lucky, and when I was eating that piece of potato, to me, it tasted, because I was so hungry, it tasted just as good as for you now, a slice of pizza with extra cheese. Here is 7 cigarette butts, and I never smoked. And I'm going to tell you why I have them. This is potato that taught me a lesson that I'm going to share with you, how to survive, how to make your life better as you grow up. And we got a piece, this is for 8 people. So we had to designate a person to make sure to cut even 8 slices, because when you're hungry, every crumb counts. But there's no way we could do it because the middle one was also always the largest one. So we took 8 pieces of paper and we put from 1 to 8 in each piece of bread and 8 pieces of paper in a cellophane bag. Whatever you picked was yours. In my group of 8 was a father and son. The father got the end, the son got the middle piece. And I witnessed myself. The father said to the son, you know, I need more energy than you. Let's change around. I give you my end, you give me the middle. He thought for a minute and he said, no, I'm just as hungry as you are. I cannot help you. Now I realized to be in the camp, you're all by yourself. You can't help nobody if you have extra and nobody's gonna help you. So now, because I come from a family with try to give charity, so I figured I'm gonna train my brain to be like that, to be selfish. And I'll tell you what happened. After I got married, and the first time I took my wife for dinner, she liked what I ordered. She said, can I taste it? My brain told me, if I give her, I'm gonna have less. So actually I told her that I'm very hungry, I can't do it. And then I realized this is not the way of living. When my children asked me for spending money, I gave it to them. But I know if I give them, I'm gonna have less. So now I know I have to retrain my brain to be charitable. So what I did is, the first thing I wrote a check to an organization that means I have to give. I was driving on the boulevard, it was a red light. Teenagers like you were selling a bottle of water. Not only did I buy one, I bought 2, just to train my brain to be charitable. Even though a couple of blocks before I already bought. If somebody was selling flowers in the wintertime, and I could tell this guy didn't have a sale for an hour, because they look half frozen, I bought him anyway. My pleasure was to see his face light up when he did the sale. But one day was different. I got stopped at a red light, and a man has a sign, he says, I'm hungry, I'm willing to work for food. But the sign was on the ground, and he was signing himself. I said, excuse me, how do you expect to make a living? You're signed on the ground, you're signing yourself. He said, I'm on my coffee break. So you see, it doesn't matter what you do for a living, you need a coffee break. So now I'm back in the camp, and as we were marching, the man to my right said to me, if I survive, I'm not going to believe in God. I said, why not? 2 days ago, I had a wife and a 10-year-old son, and I'm all by myself. How could God do something like this? The man to my left overheard this conversation. He said, I never believe in God, but if I survive, I'm going to believe in God. So everybody has a different opinion about what's happening in these camps. And because this is the first time God was in the conversation, that night I dreamt about God. I dreamt that we are in a room with no windows, and it was more like outer space, and we were talking to each other, but I couldn't get used to that kind of air. It was very, more like made me sneeze, but I'm not gonna sneeze in front of God. But eventually, God sneezed, and I didn't know what to say. So those are the things that happened in the camp. I remember one time at night, I could not fall asleep. When you're hungry, when you're tired, and if it was a rainy day, your clothes is wet, you really cannot sleep. All of a sudden, I hear the American planes are coming, and when that happens, all the lights go out, dark like anything. So I figure, you know what? I know what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna run to the kitchen, get some food, and come home. Going there was no problem. Coming back, if the light comes on, there were towers, in each tower was a soldier. He has the right, anybody who walks has the right to shoot you. But when you're hungry, you take chances like that. So I'm coming back, I'm almost near my barrack, and I'm attacked by three prisoners who are just going to the kitchen. They decided, why should we put our life in danger? Let's attack Ernie. And they took away my food. And when it was all over, one of my shoes was missing. Either they took it, or it was dark, I didn't see it, and I'm not about to go look for it, and I know I gotta be home any minute. So now I have to hope that the next day is not going to be snowing. Sure enough, it was snowing. And what I did is I cut a piece from the blanket, wrapped it around my foot. That's how I went to work. Coming home, the soldier who was watching me noticed, and he gave me a slip to go to the warehouse to get new shoes. The problem was, as younger the soldier is, as meaner he is to you. If he's a middle age, he might feel sorry for you. This guy was not older than 19. I give him the slip. He don't ask me what size. Whatever he put his hand, he gives me. I go home, they're a size too small. There's no way I was able to keep up with the rest of the group. And the soldier near me said, look, I can't get behind just with you. I give you two choices. Either I shoot you right here, or take off your shoes and walk barefooted. So that's the only choice I had. So instead of walking, I'm more like jumping, walking, my toes not to freeze. When I got to the destination, I saw all kind of prisoners. I figured I'm going to look around, maybe somebody smaller than me, and his shoes are too big. Around 12 o'clock, I found somebody like that. And everybody told me, if you survive today, you're going to survive. So finally, in the meantime, you go from camp to camp. Everybody knows it doesn't matter as long as you don't wind up in Camp 7. Camp 7 is the end of the line. Once you're there, then you know this is the end of you. One time we come home and the soldier realized I'm not producing enough that day. So he signed me up to go to Camp 7. So I went to Camp 7. There, you're only there for the longest 3 days. Most of the time, just 2 days. They don't feed you no more. And because you're not working, you don't get no food. Finally, the train came again, but this time was not standing room only, but nobody was able to stand. Everybody was like sitting on the floor. And finally, the destination was to Dachau. And when we got there, there's this long line. And we knew already why we were in this line, but that you don't care already. You're too hungry, too tired, and you just give up. So I know I was getting closer. My legs couldn't carry my body anymore. I was just dragging. Finally, I was close enough to see the building, the crematorium. So I said to myself, in half an hour, everything's going to be over. And all of a sudden, something unusual happened. The soldier near me, he's throwing down his weapon, and he's running away. I don't know why. I don't know what to do. What happened next, I have no recollection. All I know, the next day, I was in a sanatorium to recuperate. I was there for about 6 weeks. In the meantime, I already know that I lost four, but I don't know what happened to my two other brothers. Whether they survived or, well, anyway, they also designated a room where people would like to go for services. One morning I go for services, the door opened. No matter how you pray, you want to know who's coming in. And I see it's my older brother, his name is Abraham. This is the first time in my life I was happy and sad. Happy to see him. If he came alone, that means my other brother didn't survive. That's the first question I ask him, because the other brother's name was David, and he was my favorite. I said, where is David? He said, I'll tell you later. And he told me he died of starvation. So now, now we are two. And he said to me, why don't we go home? Maybe we see some more. So we found there two more, a brother and a sister, and we knew we cannot be there anymore. So everybody went wherever they were able to go. Because I was under 21, and I don't have any parents, I was able to come to the United States. And when I came to the United States, I know that I have to find somebody who liberated me to think and the reason I'm here. So after many, many years, I found Dan Greenbaum, and we are, like, we grew up together. And there's a lot of reasons for it, because my favorite brother was David, and he was 5 years older than me. His name is Dan, also starts with a D, and he's 5 years older than me. So every time when I talk to him, I feel like I'm talking to my brother. So before you ask me any question, I'm going to, this is only students only, especially you are in the front, you will know the answer right away. My first question is, does anybody, whoever, it's going to be your job who raises the hand first. Does anybody remember my number? Raise your hand. See? Who? Okay.
Yes.
To me, right?
366.
Yeah.
What was the name of my favorite brother? I guess you can get it. Now this one here, you have to be good in math. I'm 88 years now. How old was I in 1945? You couldn't do it this fast.
No, you did too. Yeah, 1945, how old was I?
You said 15.
That was your foot. No.
19.
No, you can't guess. You have to figure it out.
88 today, right?
Yeah.
And so what year, how old were you in 1945 when you were liberated?
Okay. 17.
Okay.
Now, listen to this. I'm going to ask the next question. You make sure you know who raised the hand first. Turn it on. No, you stay here. Wait till I ask the question. Then. Okay, ready? This is the last one I have. Who would like to own it?
Yeah. All right, okay. Go give it to him then.
Give it to him.
All right, thanks. All right, how about a round of applause for Ernie and Don? We have time for a couple more questions, but I think it's important. Why is it important to listen to what these men are telling you today? The reason is, can you hear me? Okay. If we're not aware of history, then we're destined to repeat it. And it is important to understand, especially when 50 years later somebody comes on the news and says, that never happened. The absolute craziness of how a human being can treat another human being and what happened in Nazi Germany and across Europe in the extermination of over 6 million Jews and many, many others, simply because they were of a certain faith or a certain skin color or a certain practice of religion. Those are the things that can happen in a civilized, supposedly civilized country like Germany was in the 30s. So it's important, you talk about the United States of America. Going to war is something nobody wants to do, Anyone that serves in the military knows that's the last possible option. But guys like Don Greenbaum signed up because we were under attack, and they fought to rid the world of this crazy dictator in Germany and the Axis powers. And we owe so much to that greatest generation. So I want a special round of applause for Don and all the veterans of World War II.
Thank you, thank you. There's one thought that has never left me in over 70 years, and that is these German officers would go home at night and take their kids to the movies and have dinner with their wife and have a good laugh, knowing the next day they're going to go out and push people into gas chambers and kill people they never even heard of, even knew. And it has never left me in 74 years, and it never will leave me. And that's why my message to you again is, please go back and repeat our stories to other people so it shall not die. Thank you.
I got one more thing, too. But the most important thing I forgot to tell you, this is going to help you adjust your life to have a better life. There's a Hebrew word in, it's called tzedakah. Tzedakah means, has two meanings. First meaning is, if you could afford, you should give charity. You have to say to yourself, it's always better to give than to take. It's always better to help somebody than somebody to help you. The other meaning is to be nice to each other. Everybody counts. Nobody looks alike. So nobody's left behind. You have to be nice to each other. You don't bully around because somebody's a little heavier or somebody you don't like his teeth. This is in the past. There's no room no more for bullying. And when you go for lunch and you see one table, a person eats by himself, you don't have to be with your friends all the time. You go over and say, can I have lunch with you? To make him feel he's counted. So my message to you is, well, here is only boys. I'm only saying when you get out of here, you got to make sure that you find somebody that you really like, that both like each other. Once you establish that one, then you have to get a hobby. A hobby is like taking care of a dog, taking care of a plant, texting. That's not a hobby. Once you get that, then you got to find a job. You got to find a job that you really like to go to the job, not that you don't feel like going. Once you have that one, then you have to believe everything is happening because there's a God who controls the world. If you follow this instruction, your life is going to be much better.
All right. Thank you. I'm just going to close by what I talked to the students about, right? You're always in charge of your own attitude. And for a man like Ernie Gross that saw the absolute worst in humanity as a 15, 16, 17-year-old young man, to not only persevere and survive through that, but to keep his faith in God, to keep his faith in humanity, and to be able to move forward in his life is a true inspiration, I think, to all of us. So I'm going to say one more time how much I appreciate Don and Ernie coming here and sharing their stories with us today.